Up until now, our discussions in this class have dealt with what we refer to as DC or constant voltages. The batteries that we've talked about, the batteries are a 1.5 volt, a 9 volt, a 12 volt battery. The point is that those voltages are constant. They don't vary with time. We're now ready to turn our attention to time-varying signals and the use of oscilloscopes to display those time-varying signals. My name is Lee Brinton, and I'm an electrical engineering instructor at Salt Lake Community College. We're going to make the distinction then between constant voltages and time-varying voltages. We'll talk about the different types of time-varying voltages, which include transitional or transient voltages. Then we'll also talk about AC voltages, signals that vary over time in either a periodic or a random way, but not just transitioning from one constant value to another constant value. And we'll then talk about, and this video is going to introduce to you the oscilloscope and go over the different functions that an oscilloscope can perform and demonstrate, or at least teach you about the basic functional groups of the oscilloscope control knobs. Okay, up until now, we've had DC quantities, DC voltages, DC currents. That 1.5 volt battery, we were interested only in what is the voltage of it. Is it a brand new battery that's maybe up at around 1.7 or 1.8 volts, or is it starting to get a little bit old and sagging down at 1.1 or 1.2 volts? A single number, though, told us everything there was to know about that DC voltage or DC current. And a standard digital multimeter does that great. There's only one number, it can display that number, it can even give us a couple of decimal places of accuracy. But when we have time-varying signals, say a sinusoidally varying signal, what if we were to want to represent that signal with a single number, what number would we represent it with? Well, it turns out that digital multimeters do have an AC reading, and the number that they use is what is known as the RMS value, which is something of an average value. We'll spend more time talking about RMS later on in your careers as students, but suffice it to say for now that the digital multimeter, when measuring AC voltages, produces a single number that is related in some way to its average value, which is known as the RMS or the root mean squared value. But as we've already mentioned, there's a whole lot more interesting voltages than just single voltages. In fact, if you think about it, there's really not much information in DC voltage. Information can be encoded in time-varying signals. And they've got three different types of time-varying signals here that just to talk about. First of all, there's the single event. It's a transition. We sometimes refer to it as a transient, where we may have some kind of a switch or a switching event take place that goes the machine from off or from one state to another state. But generally speaking, it doesn't transition from one state to another state instantaneously. It takes time because of something known as capacitance. And we'll spend more time later on in the semester talking about capacitance. But suffice it to say for now, the capacitance prevents an electrical circuit from moving from one position to another position or another state instantaneously. And that switching causes a single event. It is varying with time. And we may very well want to study that transient, and an oscilloscope will allow us to do it. Another type of time-varying signal are the periodic signals, where they repeat themselves every so often over a period of time that is known as its period. The length of time that it takes for the signal to repeat itself is known as the period, sometimes given capital T, or represented as capital T. And then there are the random signals. And the random signals probably are going to be the most interesting. And by random, we mean that they're varying randomly with time. Voice signals, radio signals, and things like that, they may not be completely random, but on the other hand, they're not periodic. When I'm talking, my voice is randomly or effectively randomly moving. If it was periodic, such as just a single tone, I can make a single tone, or in fact, I can't make a single tone. There's a number of tones combined in it. But when I start changing my voice and putting words to it, all of a sudden we're encoding meaning into the waveforms. And an oscilloscope will allow us to look at those types of waveforms also. There are a number of standard types of waveforms that we'll be using over and over again. We've already talked about the exponentially charging waveform. There are also sinusoidal waveforms that have or that can oscillate at a specific frequency. And the frequency is related to how quickly it changes. So this is a sinusoid of a given frequency, and if it was oscillating more slowly, it would have a lower frequency. And so we can use the oscilloscope to measure the frequency. How quickly does it go through a cycle? We can use an oscilloscope to measure the amplitude. How strong is that sinusoidal voltage? And we can also use the oscilloscope to measure something that is known as the phase, or the relative position of this amplitude relative to zero. Another interesting type of signal that we'll be using and looking at is the exponentially decaying sinusoid. It's a sinusoid that is decaying with an exponential envelope. And we can use the oscilloscope to measure how quickly it's decaying, and from that then have a feel for how quickly the circuit is responding. Finally, there are square waves or digital signals where the waveform is switching between one constant voltage and another constant voltage. And again, that type of time-varying signal can be displayed on an oscilloscope. This is a picture of the type of oscilloscopes we have in the lab. You'll notice that an oscilloscope consists of a video display screen that has a grid on it. Basically, it's an X, Y grid. Now, the horizontal axis represents time, and the vertical axis represents voltage. So an oscilloscope can display time-varying voltages. If you want to look at currents, it won't do a current. You need to find a place like a voltage across the resistor where the current is related to, or the current is simply a scaled version of the voltage. Now you'll notice on this oscilloscope, the picture here, there's actually two different waveforms being displayed. These oscilloscopes are actually able to display four different signals simultaneously. It's known as a four-channel oscilloscope, and we can hook up four different signals using a coaxial cable connecting to what's known as a BNC connector, or a British Naval connector. So a connection for each of the four channels is provided, and it allows us then to look at four different signals. You'll notice that each of the channels is color-coded. So the signal that's being displayed on channel 1 is going to be yellow, channel 2 blue, channel 3 purple, and channel 4 green. So the whole purpose of the oscilloscope is for us to look at time-varying voltages. Now, as you look at the scope, you'll notice that there's a whole bunch of knobs and buttons, and it can be a little bit intimidating. But they are divided up into functional groups that once we get comfortable with that, it makes them a whole lot less intimidating. You'll notice in particular that there are three silk-screened groups here, here, and there. Then there are a series of soft programmable buttons. And then there are a bunch of other kind of odds and ends or miscellaneous functions that are available through these switches. And then this knob here is a multi-purpose knob. Turning it will have different functions or perform different functions depending upon the state of the oscilloscope, depending upon what it is you're trying to accomplish. So let's start, first of all, with this largest group. As we've already pointed out, there's four different channels that are available, and the buttons and knobs associated that are lined up here all have to do with channel 1. You'll notice that this silk screening says vertical. this part here deals with the vertical scaling and the vertical positioning of the signals. And each channel has its own set of knobs. So really, we just have to learn what these three buttons and knobs perform, because they'll do the same thing. These three do the same thing as those, only it does it for channel 2 and channel 3 and channel 4. This knob right here establishes the scale, the vertical scale. As we mentioned, and you can see that this is basically an XY plot. And these major divisions can, the scaling on the major divisions are controlled by this knob. The scales can be as small as millivolts and can be as great as tens of volts. So it allows us to display things on the order of milli or microvolts in the small end, and on up to a number of hundred volts, if you do it correctly, on the upper end. And that scaling is set by turning this knob. The volts per division scale is displayed over here in this lower left-hand corner. Now, we currently have two channels in use, and so this channel one here is telling us that it's 1.1 volts per division, this is 1.1 volts per division, or something like that. So each different signal can have its own scale, and to know what the scaling is, or what the how many volts each of those divisions represents, is displayed down here. This knob right here controls the relative position of the waveform. You can raise the waveform up or drop it down by using that knob. And you'll notice that there are little colored arrows here showing what, or as showing where 0 volts is. And by adjusting this, you then adjust the zero position either up or down. This push button here turns on a menu of options that are associated with channel 1. So you can, by pushing the yellow button, you bring up the options for channel 1. Push the blue button, it brings up those same options for channel 2, and so on. In this silkscreened area, the knobs are all associated with the horizontal axis. The horizontal axis in an oscilloscope is generally going to be the time axis. We're typically talking about time-varying functions, and the domain along here then is time. This knob establishes the seconds per division. This gave us the volts per division on the vertical axis. This establishes the seconds per division along the horizontal axis. And it can be as small as microseconds and can be as great as a number of seconds per division, and that value is set by this. And then right here in the middle, it tells you what the current scaling is. In this case, it's 1 millisecond per division. So with 1 millisecond per division, there's 10 divisions across here, you'd be able to display 10 milliseconds of a time-varying signal. This knob right here positions or shifts the trace left or right. Now, this group of buttons up here deal with what is known as the triggering function. Now, because we're typically looking at periodic signals, or signals that repeat themselves, and they're continually repeating, but we can only see a small portion of that continuously repeating signal. So what the triggering level does is it establishes a voltage that the signal will start to display at. And by starting at that same voltage, the display then goes through, you know, on the display you'll see that much time, and then it starts over, and it always starts at the same place so that the trace remains stationary. If it started at different voltage levels each time, the signal would wander back and forth. So the triggering level gives us establishes or allows us to stabilize the image. These other buttons perform a number of different functions, including an auto reset or a factory default option, and there's also a run stop option. The run stop option allows you to freeze the display and stop it from refreshing. So whatever you're seeing, if you see something that is unique or something that you want takes a longer time to look at that's not periodic, you can push the run stop button and it'll freeze the display. This knob right here we've already mentioned, I guess, is the multi-purpose knob, and depending upon the state of the oscilloscope, it performs different functions. This button right here is the print button. It allows you to save the signals that are being displayed to a USB storage device. Now, because these are digital scopes, they have CPUs and they have memory. And because of that, these oscilloscopes are also able to perform mathematical operations on the signals that you're looking at. You can add signals together, you can subtract them, you can perform what is known as spectral analysis using an FFT or fast Fourier transform function, and display the frequency content of the signal that you're looking at. In those circumstances, this horizontal axis will be a frequency domain axis rather than a time domain axis, and going across here will represent differences in frequency. The mathematical options are brought up onto the menu by pushing the math menu. Well, there's a whole lot more that we could talk about, but that gives us a good overview of the oscilloscope and the knobs and the types of functions that the oscilloscopes can perform. And so it's now time for us to just get into the lab and start using these things and learn by using.